Good afternoon and welcome to the museum. It's so great to have so many of you here today, especially at a midday event, and to celebrate the 35th anniversary of the museum in all of its forms, and we're going to talk about all of those today. Let me just say that on behalf of the trustees and the staff and our volunteers, it's just an amazing thing to welcome all of you here today and to think back on everything that's happened in the field of the history of computing as told by first the Computer Museum and then the Computer History Museum. And now for today's event, one of my earliest childhood memories was the birthday party, the 85th birthday party of a great aunt of mine back in Texas. And I remember asking her what it was like to be turning 85. And she said, well, you could call this my 85th birthday, but what I really prefer to think of it is as is the 85th anniversary of the day something wonderful happened to my mother. 35 years and 2 days ago, something wonderful happened to, well, to all of us, really. It was the birth of a new institution. It was called the Digital Computer Museum, not because it was about digital computers necessarily, but because it was the historic brainchild of two executives of the Digital Equipment Corporation, Gordon Bell and Ken Olson. It was a new and truly original idea, and the world has never been quite the same. Every successful institution like ours has a patriarch or a matriarch or more than one, but few are fortunate enough to have them be so deeply involved across the years and across the decades, or in the case of Gordon Bell, across an entire generation. This museum, the Computer History Museum, is very fortunate to be one of those places and to have not one, but two, Gordon Bell and Lynn Shustek. Gordon is not only the co-founder of this museum's predecessor in Boston, but he served continuously on the board of all the versions of the museum from day one until today, and of course he's still a trustee here at this museum. Lynn is the founder and chairman of the Computer History Museum in California, and no institution could ask for anyone to do more than Lynn has done for us. They are both the keepers of the flame, and they are the best possible people to come up today and to talk a little bit about the history of the institution and how we got where we are now. Please join me in welcoming Gordon Bell and Lynn Shustek. Well, let me start before we get started today just by saying thank you to all of you, because you are part of the community that is helping to build this institution and make it great. Clearly, you've been involved with us for a long time, some of you going back many, many decades, and that's a really, really special thing. So thank you for everything you've done to help make the Computer History Museum a success. And we're going to talk a little bit about history now, and we're going to give you the history of this museum in pictures. These are just a few, and we have a lot more. So the big question when the Computer History Museum was being born, or the original Computer Museum in Boston, was who is going to preserve the history of computers? And is that even an important thing to do? This is the picture of all the Computer History Museums in the world that existed before 1979. But as I mentioned, then something really wonderful and amazing happened. And we have a little bit of video.
Introduce Professor Morris Wilkes from the, who's head of the computer laboratory at the University of Cambridge. Before I do, I want to point out that there is a reception afterward in the new Digital Computer Museum that I'd like to encourage you to visit and fill out the form as to what to do with it. Names are optional, of course. And then the other announcement is that afterward, Professor Wilkes will take questions, and there are mics throughout the audience. So,
but we were very hard up. It was a great gift. And they built a computer called Leo 1, which was a logical copy of the EDSEC. It was, the engineering was gone over to a considerable extent. Had mercury tank memories.
All right, okay. Okay. Here. Okay. Okay. Okay.
So, Gordon, there you were, introducing Sir Morris Wilkes and then cutting the ribbon with Ken Olson and opening the original round of exhibits. How did you get Morris Wilkes to come and be the speaker for the opening of the museum?
Actually, I think I had just hired Morris to be in our research group. He was retiring from the Cambridge lab, but I had known him for quite a while, as I had known all the pioneers, or had known many of the pioneers, and so I basically asked him to give his talk, or talk about EDSAC, which is an absolutely wonderful, he ended up with a wonderful talk, which is on the web, which you can see, but talks about EDSAC and how programming was EDSAC. But that was the intent. We sort of also said he's the first of all the pioneers, in which our goal was to collect all the pioneers.
All the pioneers,
yeah.
We're going to learn about the history of the Digital Computer Museum and then the Computer Museum in a kind of unconventional way. You've built a walkthrough of a website that is part of the archive of TCM, and I'm going to hand you the clicker and turn it over to you.
Great. I have to point out that I think it was about 15 years ago when the museum was starting, was I was on the side of really we need to have, all we need is a virtual museum. And so this was my chance to do it. So basically what I've tried to do here is create as near as possible the cyber museum that I hoped that this museum would be. But on the other hand, I was wrong about this museum. And having a physical museum turned out to be useful. otherwise, we wouldn't. You might all have been here, but we wouldn't see you.
You miss all these smiling faces.
But anyway, last night I decided, gee, let's take a tour of that museum. And so here's a click-by-click tour. If the first thing you see at this is tcm.computerhistory.org is a place that takes you to various parts of the museum that are the libraries and the artifacts. And so this is one of the landing pages. The other landing page is the timeline that shows year by year some of the key events that we're looking at. And for example, one of the key events was a book called Computer Structures that Alan Newell and I wrote while I was at Carnegie Mellon, and that served as a model of having all the computers that we wanted to collect, plus it outlined a taxonomy and a structure and ways and framework for computing that, in fact, the Computer Museum used, and to a certain extent, the Computer History Museum uses not as much as I'd like, but at least the remnants are there. And this all came from this book.
What year did you and Alan Newell first publish that book?
That was published in 71, and I think the book is still as fresh as it was then. It's still, people haven't discovered the back part of the book, which is the appendix that has all of the parts of computers. I think probably only two or three people have ever looked at it. it took Alan and I became a taxonomist, or an amateur taxonomist, after the book and got very interested in that. So the book was a key part of it. Ken, of course, was another key part. This was outside the mill building, and then this was, to a large extent, Ken and Bob Everett, who were the inventor, helped usher in the core memory. Ken built the first core memory computer. And then this is a piece of Whirlwind. Ken wanted to, they both wanted to preserve a whirlwind. And by then, Ken and I totally agreed that the Smithsonian, this is not something that we can leave to the government to do. We've got to do it. And so we ended up that being our kind of a model. And so here's the whirlwind was collected. And so the museum has one of the core memories, and then we gave one of the core memories back to MIT for their museum.
Now, you know, I've always felt actually that was a fascinating part of this museum story, because we hear about private art collections becoming the kernel for great public art museums. Jefferson's personal library became the start of the Library of Congress. It's interesting to think that the Computer History Museum, as it stands today, actually began because you and Ken started a private collection of parts of computers that you felt were going to be historic and needed to be preserved.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct. And this all started, we had an exhibit in the Mill Building. This is the Building 12. And it started all in a coat closet, a converted coat closet of Building 12, where we had a number of the artifacts. And this was, Ken and I were on the first floor of this building. The whole building ended up, I think it's almost 1 million square feet in this Mill Building complex. But this Building 12 was where Deck started and where the museum essentially started. And so in the lobby we had that that exhibit, we don't have a photograph of.
We used the phrase coat closet in the original invitation we sent out for this event. And I got a very angry letter from someone who'd been involved all the way back to Boston, and he said, look, I know that the museum today has grown to be into, you know, a really nice thing and all that, but you didn't have to call the original museum a coat closet. And I said, well, we got that from Gordon Bell. Yeah. So after I told him that, he sent me a very nice email back and said, well, okay, I feel much better now.
No, it was the coat closet. I don't know where the people put their coats after that. But anyway, this was the lobby that people would come into to visit this part of digital. And then going back, then the other thing there in this coat closet was... we had a brochure associated with that, and this called Computer Generations, which followed the model, and it had four generations here of vacuum tubes, transistors, integrated circuits, and computers, computer on a chip. So that we had a model, a time model, a generational model that the brochure used. Going back here to the landing site and looking at some of the things, this was the a collection of the, if you go to the page asking for the annual reports, it's called the reports page on the landing site. There are the first 10 years of reports that were turned out to be annual reports, which reported on all of the lectures and membership and boards and things like that. And then the next 10 years were on the part below. Those are you can download those as two PDFs, and they're about, when you put them all together, there's about 700 pages of that.
You had a very active publishing ethos at the Computer Museum. It really is quite a documentary record of the life of the museum almost from day one. Why did you know then that was going to be important to you?
I don't know. It was just something about the way I was learned to do engineering that, you know, you plan the thing, you do it, you then open it and sell it, and then you write about it. And so essentially this is from my standpoint, this is a complete cycle for me for the Computer Museum, not the Computer History Museum, but the Computer Museum, because we're finished. We have opened the Computer Museum again, and it's sort of all there, the best that we can do. And the regret, which I'm hoping that, I'm pretty sure we're not going to make that mistake here, is that we keep every exhibit, so essentially the museum is only an increasing thing in cyberspace. It's always there, and basically it can live forever. And so that would have been the goal here, and that's kind of a prototype of how I think museums should be. So this is essentially the library back end room, and then if you go to some of the publications, here's the first museum report, the publications, and on there you can see a timeline going back to, I think, 1600 of the various eras that we had selected that were important in computing, going back to manual Napier's bones and quipus, and I don't think we got quipus on there, but the way we did collecting. And then the other thing that's important there in the museum was the way that we collected the board members. And so I feel very strongly about who you know, getting people on the board. And if we look at the board, it was at the top was Charlie Bachman, who built the first database. Les Hogan, who was instrumental in the, I think was in fact president of Fairchild and also Motorola at a time, one of the fathers of the integrated circuit. Bob Everett was the head of MITRE and developer. There's one I'm particularly proud of, Bob Noyce, who this allowed me to become very friendly with Bob and to get to know him and the incredible warmth and personality there. And and Brian Randall, who was the best historian at that, known historian, had written a book at the time. Michael Spock, who ran the Children's Museum, and then we ended up with a senator from Massachusetts there. Erwin Tomasch, of course, had founded Data Products, and so these were people that all had an interest in really a support in going out and really fanning out and being part of the museum, and that was part of the first report. Going back to the museum again, land site. This was the back room. There are a couple of things here which I'm not sure I can point. That's too hard to point at. There are two folder files on here that are kind of interesting. There are 200 letters I wrote, basically twisting arms, begging, trying to get money. So you'll see how begging has changed over the years.
Hasn't changed much.
Lynn has looked at mine, and I hope. And then the other one was Gardner Henry, who's coming today, but is on the board member. And if you look at his collection of all of his documents while he was chairman of the board, all the things that he saved, there's a mere PDF file with 2,200 pages in it. So for those of you who like large PDFs with everything in one of them, that's the place to go, and you can search those about a lot of the history of the museum. This is the landing site for marketing, and these are various parts of marketing that was done. And
what was your marketing philosophy? I mean, here you are running something entirely new. I mean, the computer itself was new, and this was before the era of personal computing. So the personal involvement people had with computing was almost non-existent. What was your strategy for getting people interested in this?
It was really Gwen doing a lot of different things, but I mean, our philosophy was put out the maximum amount of good information. So good bits about history and why we're doing it and things like that, and then that goes into the product announcements and stuff like that.
And then it would find an audience.
And yeah, and we and get members, get a lot of members, and get them involved. So there was and getting PR from that, and you know, having that board initially, those people were telling other people and so on, and then getting people who would give artifacts. So getting a community that really felt that the preservation was important was a key part of that. And then if you look at some of one of those, right at the very beginning, it was Gwen felt we needed a store. And this is the first store catalog. And you can see the museum had its own apparel, probably taken from the SGI philosophy of having wearing apparel, but cufflinks, a tie. This is from the 1982 tie, which, by the way, I was going to give Len today, which I will give Len later on. But he turns out he's got the gray version. I only had two of the red versions. And then it had a belt, which I'm not going to give because my pants will fall down. But and so Gwen had made a lot of things like that that were going to spread the thing. And by the way, one of the things that we also had, we made a lot of posters. So posters were used to get people interested in that. This is not our poster. This is a poster I stole and photographed, and it's probably illegal. But you can download this. This is, to me, the world's best poster ever on the history of computing, sort of up to 1965. It's done by the Science Museum. I scanned it, put it on there. It's, if you go into the marketing stuff, you'll find this poster and a lot of posters about DAC. They had a beautiful thing like the memories poster and so on.
We should talk. You're referring a lot to Gwen. And for those who don't know, we might want to just mention at this point, Gwen was your wife, Gwen Bell, very much a full partner in the building of the museum, the lead curator, the lead marketing person, the lead editor and publications agent, the lead bookkeeper. I mean, she really was instrumental to all of it.
Right. Yeah. Otherwise, I mean, if it hadn't been for somebody doing it, I was there coaching and occasionally, helping write letters and stuff like that and arm twisting. But in fact, Gwen was there day in and day out. I was also trying to run engineering at DAC at the same time, which turned out to be very useful because very often I need a little bit of industrial design or photographers or people to build a, would you mind building me a few museum cases and moving them over there? And the industrial design guys loved this because it was sort of a different problem.
Sure.
And so we did very well with DAC. This is another one. If you have gone to the, I think we got, I don't have the immediate land, but this was, if you open the digital museum, get at the digital museum, this is the site you'll see in some of the artifacts that are there. And sort of in the middle there is this document. This is a scan document that Ed Thalen did that he had found somewhere, and this was the museum catalog. Mm. Gwen felt very strongly about museum catalogs. In the old days before cyber museum, before cyber collections and databases, a museum published a catalog which had all of its holdings. And so this was the first catalog that was done, and it talks about the importance of a catalog and the use of Linnaean structure. And so we had that. We had a taxonomy that these are parts of that we were using that came memory and control and I/O and then the computer itself and automata, because we tried to collect many of the parts that we would consider part of the computer as possible. And so we had a taxonomy with that, and then we also had the notion of generations and the generations. And there's a beautiful post, well, at least I think it's beautiful, poster of the pre-computing generations, and we named four pre-computing generations going back from vacuum tubes through relays to mechanical devices, then to manual things that people put together with their hands. And so that was kind of the generational thing, which I still maintain today to a large degree of what the technology is.
What do you remember were the most important first acquisitions that you were able to make?
I was very happy that we got 6600 number one from Livermore. And I should mention George Michael, who was probably one of the father of supercomputing, was on the board. And so they were just decommissioning the 6600. We got that. And so I think that was up there because, in a sense, because it's such a beautiful machine.
This is the control data 6600.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And and then we had the encoding device,
the Enigma.
We have. It's debatable, but I'm pretty sure all the things say there were two Enigmas, and one Enigma the museum has, and I hope the museum has the other museum hidden in a box somewhere, but we have been unable to find it. But the Enigma were important because of the rarity, and then there were little pieces of like an early Napier's bones. Now that was a collection. We said the computer museum cannot collect pre-computing stuff because it's, you know, we're talking about saving the computer. And so Gwen and I started in about 75 of collecting things that would go into pre-computing stuff like, in fact, the first one was the Millionaire, that monster calculator that first multiply divide that was late 1800s. 1800s calculator that was part of the collection. Mm-hmm. So those things were all were described in this catalog. So an IO, we started collecting typewriters at one point, and then we got into that. I know we got up to 50 or so, and I said, these things are dull and hopeless. Let's get I think we gave them away or whatever. I think the museum still has a few of them.
Sure.
But there were calculators. There are lots of, and then also we collected a lot of the key calculators that were more involved. Anyway, so this is the landing page, by the way, for the exhibits, and each of those exhibits you click on and you get a particular exhibit. I try to go back and this was what was in Maynard in the closet. Actually, Vicky Rosiski, who's worked, has put the site all together occasionally with a little help from me. And then if you click on that top thing, you get this. And this is a collage of stuff we think was in there. And right now I would like to offer, I don't know, $250 for the person who can name the most artifacts in that. I think there are 150 artifacts in there. You know, like...
Are you disqualifying Lynn?
No, I think everybody, I mean, I'd almost even let myself do it. I don't think I can remember. You know, there's an Atlas board in there, a piece of an English electric deuce, a piece of Iliac II, you know, so I can see a few of the weird things, but people can go to the site and go to the digital computer museum exhibit and then find this find this collage, and then it ought to be a contest. And of course, I'll let Dag be the judge of this, of what those artifacts are. There's anyway, we had fun putting this together as, okay, this represents the way the closet was a little better organized than this, but it has all the various artifacts in there. Then if we go out to Marlborough and you look at the Marlborough site, you clicked on the Marlborough exhibit, then here's was what was going on in Marlborough. If you amplify that, that's the layout of, well, that's the building up there, which is designed by Vincent Kling, which was an RCA building that Deck bought because we bought low because RCA was getting out of the business. Absolutely beautiful building. It should have been built on sort of Park Avenue or so. The lobby was a Park Avenue kind of lobby. Mm. All you could do with it is put a museum in it, as Gwen reasoned and then took over. And then, because there was a lot of space for that. And these are the parts that were there. That big thing with the X there was where we had the four generations. And so there was a nice area where all of the generational logic was in there. We got it. Turned out we got the first IBM MIT from, I think it was actually one of the IBMers gave it to us. By the way, we had a nice relationship with IBM. I knew Bob Evans and Eric Block on the technical side, and Louis Branscombe, who was the chief scientist. And so these people were very useful because IBM never dared to make a museum, but they had a lot of collections and that they went and still make available. One of the things they had was a model maker, Roberto Guitelli, who had a model making shop in downtown New York, down sort of in the Greenwich Village part of New York. And he made the Hollarith, which IBM allowed me to buy one from him. And also, I think he also made that other artifact. And then we've got the 6600 there. And then on the right, Derek Lamer of Berkeley had given us all of his number sieves. And this is, he had talked about many generations of number sieves. This is, I think, one of his first ones, a mechanical generation. And then it went up through the ley lines and then ultimately ended up with Iliac 4. And then the other part of the exhibit was the 6600. Well, that's the 6600 there. And then the rest of that, as you can see, these are the other artifacts there. There was part of Whirlwind. We had a Whirlwind exhibit. And then the TX0 was running. TX0, the person who maintained the zero at MIT kept it running. And then that was given to given back to Lincoln Lab, and that lives in their library. I don't think they run it, but we ran it and have a video of that. This is the walkthrough exhibit, and if you look in the walkthrough, this was what the walkthrough looked like. This was a large person size computer that was designed by actually Dave Patterson and I, with a bus-based machine that you could see how all the parts connected to one another, and you could see the kind of scale there that many of you who were there know what that was like. And there was this was the brochure about the various parts of the walkthrough, and then this is walkthrough 2.0, which was an upgraded computer that came out in 2000, or I think, in that time scale. And going back to the timeline, the goal here was on this timeline was to be able to use this as a navigational aid, so you can sort of walk along this timeline. The timeline is about, I don't know, 20,000 pixels long by, I think, 1,000 deep or so. And so there's a lot of bits on that. And these, a lot you can hit and they will do things. And on this timeline up there, you can see the core logo. And then on the right down there, that blue thing is, if you hit that, you'll get the script of Morris Wilkes' Pray Mr. Babbage. Morris wrote a play for the museum that was given around Christmas time that we had. And so if you want to resurrect a play about Charles Babbage, that would be a nice thing to do, to have with someday with the Babbage players.
Was that ever performed again after it was performed?
One performance.
opening and closing night.
Open and closing night, but it was a very, very gay celebration. Morris really enjoyed writing it about what he knew about, and that's the core logo, and that was designed a three wire, sort of a later core memory, and not a three wire core. Gwen took that mainly as a pattern so that you could put it on anything, and there was a scarves and ties and of course like that. Some more stuff in there. Let's see, what was this? Oh, if you click on, you can see the computer bowl up there. If you click on that computer bowl, that takes you to the landing site where all the computer bowl videos are stored.
Now talk about the computer bowl a bit and what it was and how you conceived of that.
Well, that was cooked up by, I think, Gwen and one of the, who was a venture capitalist in New England, who thought of the idea, I believe. And basically it was basically to connect the East Coast and the West Coast together and help in that, because so much of the funding of this museum was coming from the West Coast. And as Gwen said, hey, why don't we go directly to the source instead of having to travel to get the money or to get artifacts and things like that. But on the other hand, that the computer bowl was an east-west contest with the way the College Bowl was done.
There was a famous game show on television called the College Bowl.
Yeah, and it was in that model. And
it might be Stanford versus Harvard, and it might be USC versus Chicago.
Well,
and
in this case, it was the real heart of the entrepreneurs and engineers and scientists and venture capitalists on East versus West. And I'd like to say, beautiful. I know when Bill Gates was on, he spent the entire day walking around the computer museum looking at artifacts and reading up. And so it turned out he was the MVP too. So, I mean.
So he studied up.
Yeah, right. People often say, does he really know anything about computers? And I said, yeah, actually he does. But he studied, so there were a number of, the East, the West ended up, I think, sort of winning most of the contests. But they were very, very well attended. There were 10 of them, and then there is a book of all of the. A published book of all the questions and Q's and A's, and a card set of the players on one. These are like baseball cards. So the players had their own cards of that. And if you go there, that's a lot of fun. If you ever, but I doubt if anybody here can, how many people can answer those questions now?
They were hard then, and they're really obscure now.
Yeah, that's right. That's about what they were, non-trivial questions. And then let's see if what else I had here. Oh, and the other thing that the museum published, when it put the software he wrote a book, published a book on software for kids. And in fact, a couple of the early, I had started Digital Press at one point, mm-hmm. at the very beginning, and that was, we ended up with two books. One on ENIAC, from ENIAC to UNIVAC, and the other one was on about Whirlwind. And so those were, and this was in that sort of style of having a book. So these books are all online. Let's see, what else have we got here? This is the now in the 95 era, and there's the first picture of the truck that's taking the artifacts to here. This is one of the microprocessor posters.
That's a marvelous poster. We have that.
That was published, created, I think, in 1990. That, all of these posters you can easily download and get and print if you at any size if you want. They're all on the site. So I put those out as stuff that you may, for those of us who are in posters and are. Well, I'm in cyberspace now, so I don't want any of this stuff. But if you like paper posters and stuff on your walls, this is beautiful stuff to have on your wall. This is a more kind of at the end of the thing. This is we had a book, and of course, here's a picture of Gene Amdahl, was part of Wizards and Wonders book. And then that's it.
Gordon, you've given us a great gift because you not only have given us the kernel of a museum that goes on and on, but now you've memorialized it all in cyberspace, and so much of the collection, the documents, the video, the scripts, the posters, the images, the pictures, the timeline, it's all there, and it will be as long as computerhistory.org exists. So what a tremendous thing to do. And you and Vicky together, yeah. I think... I've pretty much done it yourselves, and it's just an absolutely amazing thing.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm. This is something I'm very, very proud of because I think it was a demo of kind of where I wanted these things to go, and the only regret is I can't get every exhibit the way it was when it lived. A few of them are there, namely, if you go to the walkthrough computer, you can get a movie, 25-minute movie of going through the walkthrough exhibit. I wish they were all that way, and that's something that's important to remember.
Absolutely.
Good.
So in the meantime, on the West Coast, in addition to everybody winning the Computer Bowl and yeah. providing most of the funding oh, yeah. for the museum on the East Coast, there was a young Stanford PhD named Lynn Shustek who was interested in doing something similar but very original in Silicon Valley.
When I hear Gordon talk about the museum on the East Coast and Marlborough in Boston, I think he's talking about a separate parallel universe that I didn't know anything about. Because I didn't. I vaguely knew that there was a museum of computing on the East Coast, but that wasn't my motivation. I came at it entirely differently. I had retired from doing a couple of networking startups and went back to my first career, which was teaching computer architecture and computer design at Stanford. And I taught the same course, this is 1994-95, that Ed McCluskey had taught me 25 years earlier. Same number, same content, at least same table of contents. Obviously, a lot of the content had changed because in 25 years, the computer industry had advanced. But the other thing that had changed was that the history had been taken out of the course. When I took the course, we learned about paging and virtual memory by reading the original papers that had been done by the people at Ferranti in Manchester about Atlas, the first machine that had done virtual memory and paging. But in 1994, when I was teaching this course, all of that history had been removed. And I thought this was a shame. You know, this is a relatively young field. It doesn't go back thousands of years, but it does go back 50 years. And there is a history that students ought to be learning. After all, physicists learn about Newton and Einstein, and chemists learn about Lavoisier, and mathematicians learn about Laplace. Why shouldn't computer science students learn about Turing and Babbage and von Neumann and all the rest? Well, I wasn't going to revise the curriculum of Stanford University. What I decided to do, and that it would be a good retirement project for me, was to start a museum. I mean, here we are in the center of the world for computers, now at least, Silicon Valley. Why isn't there a museum of computers? So I decided I was going to build one. So I started writing white papers. I was naive. I didn't know anything about museums, but I started shopping the idea around and talking about where it should be and how big it should be and who would fund it and who would come and why we'd need to do it and why it's important to do, because the living pioneers were still available and the original artifacts were still available. And really, if we don't do it now, we would lose the opportunity of being able to do it. Then I went around on a trip to try to look at all of the computer museums in the world, because I figured there must be a lot of them. I'll look at them. I'll use some of the best features of them as a model for my museum. And I quickly discovered there was only one, and it was the Computer Museum in Boston. And I went to visit the museum. I met Gwen Bell there. And I came back to California, and 2 weeks later, Gordon shows up in my office. And he makes a proposal. Basically, he says, don't open your own museum. Let's start a plot. It was a typical Trojan horse maneuver. You join the board of the Boston Computer Museum and restart the original history mission. By this time, in 94 and 95, the museum in Boston, and I hope I'm not overstating this, was morphing. It was turning more into a science center for kids, and a lot of the history stuff was being downplayed. There was still a marvelous collection, which if you asked Gwen to show you, she would, but it wasn't a museum anymore focused on history. So the plot that we hatched was that I would join the board, start a subsidiary in California to restart the original history mission of the museum. And we did that. I managed, the highest priority objective was to make sure that this amazing collection that Gordon and others had amassed in Boston was preserved. So we wanted to get it out here as quickly as possible. I managed to find some free warehouse space through a friend of mine at NASA at Moffett Field. Those are World War II dilapidated warehouses right in front of the big dirigible hangar. Notice the sandbags in front of the door on the right there to keep the water out. It didn't help with the leaky roof, it leaked. But this was our home, and with Gwen's help, we filled four huge tractor trailers and moved out all of the collection from Boston that wasn't then currently on display, which was most of it. And we hired furniture movers who did an okay job. I don't think too much of it got damaged, but it was tough. It was a difficult move. They had to improvise. This is part of the Sage computer, and the loading ramp on the truck wasn't big enough to move it up and down. So they had to back up two trucks to each other and use both ramps going down, they hoped, at the same rate of speed so that the machine would get to the ground in one piece.
Jeez, yeah.
Happily, it did. We ran out of space in that warehouse. We even moved stuff into the dirigible hangar. This is the side of the dirigible hangar. That's actually Carol Welsh, who is here today, I'm delighted to say, who is—
Where are you, Carol?
The only West—
Bravo. Right there.
She was the only West Coast employee of the Computer Museum, in charge mostly of working on the computer bowl and other stuff. But then when we started this West Coast outpost, she dug right into it and was really a lifesaver. This was the time, by the way, that I took the NASA course on forklift driving, and I got my my forklift driver's license, which I still have to this day, and I'm happy to say I didn't use much because I was terrible at it. So here we are cleaning these artifacts. We really had no idea what we were getting, except we knew that they were important and valuable.
Hold on just 1 second. Go back. That's Lynn, second from the left,
right,
with the rag in his hand, polishing the Sage.
There may, Gordon, have been a good catalog in 1981 when Gwen started it, but when we got it in 1996, I think the catalog covered maybe 25% of the boxes we got. So we were getting lots of boxes, and we hadn't the slightest idea what they were, but we wanted to get them out of the rain. We shoved them in the warehouse, sometimes not so prettily into the warehouse. But we had them. And then we started setting up the first version of visible storage. It was in the NASA warehouse, which was inconvenient because in order to have public access, you had to be badged into Moffett Field. So getting visitors was a challenge. And there were very few labels, just a couple. It was mostly just stuff. But the people that loved it, looking at this stuff. It had been previously unavailable. So we started trying to get publicity, advertising, describing the dream that we had for creating a new museum. This is an article that came out in the San Francisco Examiner about the Moffett Field Visible Storage Warehouse. We were actually getting some reasonably good local press, and people started paying attention. So the next question is, where should the final museum B? NASA, at the same time, was planning to turn dozens of acres of Moffett Field into a research park. And if you look down on the right there, you'll see a little arrow labeled Computer Museum. They were going to give us a land lease on 2 acres of land to build our museum. And they were going to take the dirigible hangar and turn it into a grand museum, sort of like the Smithsonian West for air and space, the California Air and Space Center. That's a great plan. Museums that co-locate, that cluster together, do well because attendance increases. So we signed on to that, said, let's go. It was a two-phase plan. The first phase was to build a beta building where we would have initially exhibits, and that would later become our warehouse. Notice that it's right at the foot of the big dirigible hangar. And then we did an architectural competition for designs for the new building that we would build on those 2 acres. And there are two of those designs. Well, a couple of things happened. One is that we realized, and in hindsight this should have been obvious, that NASA moves with the speed of a federal bureaucracy. We didn't have the patience for that. This research park was going to take a long time. And in fact, they're still talking about it, and it has yet to be built. The other thing that happened was, this was about 2000, 2001, was the dot-com bust. And suddenly, there was real estate all around Silicon Valley that was available. And in particular, the building that we're in right now, which had been the sales and marketing headquarters for Silicon Graphics, had been sold to a developer, basically, and they were holding it, trying to lease it, and were going to sell it when the market rebounded.
It's shocking to see our building with a for sale sign in front of it. I'm hoping that's the one and only time we ever see that photograph.
I hope so. So. Now the problem was, this was a great building, 7 acres of land, 400 parking spots, 120,000 square feet. It looked like a museum. Like Gordon said of the Marlboro building, the only valid purpose for this building is a museum. The people who built it and occupied it with 400 cubicles didn't realize that, but it really was designed as a museum. So I wanted this building. I lusted after this building. The problem was we were doing pretty well in our fundraising, but we had not yet gotten to the part where we had $25 million of spare cash to buy this building, and what it was going to take. So I went to the board and said, I want to borrow $25 million. There was a thud in the room. The museum in Boston had failed trying to raise, I think, less than $1 million to retire the mortgage for the building in Boston.
Right.
And that was a failed capital campaign. And here it was, I wanted to borrow $25 million and hope that future fundraising would make it up. Well, I sweated more at that board meeting than any other board meeting since, but we got permission, we borrowed the $25 million, most of which I'm happy to say now is paid off. And we moved this collection yet again. These poor computers keep getting moved from place to place. This is moving into this Shoreline building. In the meantime, we had continued collecting, so the collection was much larger, like the Cray 2 that's being offloaded here, but we had bigger forklifts now, so we were able to do a better job. And we created version 2.0 of Visible Storage, a still kind of geeky, not museum-like exhibit, but a great exhibit and a great talking tool for what it was we wanted to build. And we continued to dream, we continued to fundraise. We tried for as long as possible, which was most of the time, to stick to a rule I had instituted that every dollar into the capital campaign be split in half. 50 cents would go to buildings and exhibits and stuff that we wanted to build, and 50 cents would go into an endowment, because I knew that for an institution to exist in perpetuity, you needed to have an endowment. And we did that, and that caused us to take longer to build the final exhibit than we wanted to, but it was the right discipline. In the meantime, we were restoring old computers like 1620 originally, and this 1401, which has now been turned into a spectacular exhibit. We reinstituted the Fellows Awards program. The first one was, I think, 1987, which was Grace Hopper. And then that was an experiment, and it kind of went into abeyance for a while. The second, and I think the last one in Boston, was 1995, which was Jay Forrester, who I think is still alive. But then out in here, starting in 1996, we reinstituted the program, which has been very successful. And almost every year since, we induct fellows of the museum, trying to make heroes out of the technologists who have created the information revolution. Of course, we ran out of space, especially as we were about to build the big exhibition, so we bought a warehouse. I'm happy to say that at this point, we had done enough fundraising, so we were able to pay cash for this warehouse. We didn't borrow any money, and this is 20 minutes away in Milpitas. We have 25,000 square feet, almost full again, with an amazing collection of valuable old computers. We built temporary exhibits, like this one on the history of computer chess, again, while we were waiting to create the big exhibition and having enough money to do it. We're very peculiar that we don't like to build things before we have the money to pay for them. I don't think many nonprofits follow that discipline. We finally, of course, did get to do it. A professional exhibit, thanks to Kirsten Tashev and her team, an amazing 25,000 square foot exhibit on the history of computing that, of course, you all know a lot about. 19 galleries, 25,000 square feet. And we are working on all sorts of plans for the future. So it's been an incredible ride. It's all thanks to you. To the trustees, to the staff, to the volunteers, to the supporters, the people who saw the vision early on and helped make it. So thank you all for being part of the journey.
We're going to do a little Q&A now, and you do have question cards on your chairs. I think some cards have been collected over a few minutes, and if you have some questions that you'd like to ask Gordon and Lynn, please do hand them up. Lynn, I want to start with your belief in the fiscal discipline of the museum. You talked about that to a great extent. Why did you believe that was so important, and how difficult has it been to maintain that over the years?
In part, I believed it was important because I learned from the people like Gordon who had scar tissue from the experience in Boston. And I really believe that we needed to build an institution that would live forever. And in order to do that, you have to have fiscal discipline. I've been on the boards of other nonprofits where people become a little too starry-eyed with the mission, and they believe that somehow it will happen if they just believe hard enough. Mm. And it's not like that. You have to approach building a nonprofit the way entrepreneurs approach building a building. You have to have a fiscal plan that is grounded in reality. And yes, it was hard to do. I mean, we really wanted to build that exhibition, that 25,000 square foot exhibition. It was ready probably 3 years before we started because we didn't have the money, mm-hmm. and we needed the money. Mm-hmm. And it was tough.
Yeah, just to comment on what was happening in Boston during this whole time, because you can go look at the budgets and numbers now, it's grown. But in fact, it was sort of Gwen's creative work of going out and getting money for exhibits, using that exhibit money, part of the overhead, to really fund the next exhibit. And so it was on a particular treadmill, and fundamentally at that point, in let's face it, and by 2000, the computing in Boston was dead as a doornail. And it wasn't ever comparably, I mean, it was at one point comparably stronger than, in fact, the Valley. But the main thing, the real need to get it out of Boston was so clear because of not really the funding, but it was the fact the artifacts were being created mostly around here, and that was really, you know, again, went back to my roots of I want to collect all this stuff.
Yeah.
Incidentally, yeah. We had moved the collection in 1996, but it was still owned by the Boston Corporation. Mm. When the Boston Corporation shut down, dissolved in 1999, we had to petition to the Attorney General of the state of Massachusetts to give us permission to transfer title to a California nonprofit. Mm. When a nonprofit closes, the assets go to other nonprofits in the state. So we had to get them to make a special case.
How difficult was that?
They agreed. We never had to go to appeal, but we were prepared to appeal it and to make the case that there is no other institution in Massachusetts that would find any value in this collection.
You mentioned the 1620 project, and clearly we have some members of the 1620 restoration team here. Who worked on the 1620 restoration? Can I get to see a show of hands? Great. And as the questioner says here, we worked in the Moffett warehouse. We were baking in the summer and freezing in the winter. Do you recall the 1620 project?
Oh, very much. In fact, I love the 1620. My first paid job was as an operator of a 1620 at New York University in probably 64, 65. And I was being paid the then minimum wage of $1.25 an hour. And I was incredulous that they would pay me to play with computers. I would have gladly paid them. But I remember that restoration very well. It was one of the examples of why restorations are so difficult, because the core memory of the machine was deteriorated beyond repair. And in that particular case, we had to do a semiconductor simulation of the original memory.
Gordon, here's a question for you that isn't directly about the museum, but sort of. Ken Olson was famous, even infamous, for the quote that he wasn't sure why anybody would ever want a personal computer. But did he ever, in your time after that, as you continued to be in touch with him, did he ever acknowledge that the personal computer was something that was or would be or turned into something more than just a toy or a gadget?
Yeah, he really, in a sense, I'll say flipped probably in 1980. I don't remember when he was quoted, that quote happened, but that was at a time when personal computers were sort of coming in, or we were fighting to define them. Prior to the IBM, Wintel standard, that was, you know, DEC had basically three machines that were all in there competing with them, and he was, you know, intimately involved in the design of all of them. But in a funny way, I don't think Ken ever took the computer in that regard personally. I mean, he and I differed that way. I mean, to me, a computer is a really strong personal friend, one of us. And Ken was on the board of Ford, and I think he had more influence on the board of Ford in terms of their packaging and wiring than maybe he did at DEC, although he had an enormous amount of design engineering at DEC. But I'm not sure Ken loved computers. I mean, I love them, but so I think he didn't use computers, and somehow I feel like you've got to get very intimate with these machines before you have this feeling. And he didn't have that intimacy. That's why he probably made that quote. I had written, when I was at Carnegie in 66 or so, I was arguing for a research project that we'd put out that we'd make sure that a number of us had computers in the home. Because I had moved to Carnegie and for 66 to 72 and had one of the IBM RJE terminals, and my kids were starting to program it, do some programming at that time. But I think that he didn't. He got in with the thing, but it was mainly, gee, we've got to be there making these computers. And in a sense, some of the decisions that were made reflected the fact that he didn't understand computers. Hmm. Namely, that DEC had a beautiful PC. The cabling was wonderful. It was the best thing going. It just wasn't quite IBM compatible. He sent me one down at NSF at the time to use, I said, "Can't this stuff doesn't run all the software. There's this stuff called software that."
It's kind of important.
To customers who wrote their own software. It didn't
matter.
Yeah,
it was that, and the world had changed where it really was a compatibility story.
Huh. Oh, that's fascinating.
Yeah, but I think he just lacked that final thing about. I mean, I think during the era that one of the key eras of DEC, he was enormously talented CEO, and then there were changes, I think, in his personality that probably with the PC, and then when VAX. There was an era until VAX became famous, and then VAX became not so famous, that he liked computers.
Lynn, you were also a founder of the Homebrew Computer Club here, and there's an interesting question here, which is, to what extent did the fact that there was a homebrew bottom-up movement in Silicon Valley influence the way the museum got built out here? I mean, it's clear from your pictures that it was almost a barn raising from the very beginning. Did that community spirit that you'd already experienced with homebrew have an influence?
Yeah, we knew that we didn't have any money at the beginning. We had a very small staff, and if we wanted to make any progress, it would have to happen because we could get volunteers to accumulate around us. It wasn't hard because there was a kind of need for this thing, and people loved these old computers. There was, nostalgia drove a lot of it, which was fine. It was a community barn-raising kind of atmosphere. Mm-hmm. The fact that we were at a restricted government facility at Moffett Field made it difficult because everybody had to get badged in, but we tried to disobey the rules whenever possible.
So let me ask both of you, as trustees and people deeply steeped in all of this, if we could make a list of two or three of the most sought after artifacts that we'd most like to have, but we haven't yet been able to obtain, what would they be?
My easy answer to that was always the IBM 650, because it's the first computer I ever wrote a program for when I was in middle school in 1962 or 3. But now we have one. Thanks to Paul Pierce and a wonderful donation of old computers from a private collector in Portland. So I have to work on my next important acquisition. I don't have one at the top of my list.
Gordon, do you have a favorite on your list?
Yeah, strangely enough, it's, one I'd like to get 1108 for Dave Cutler, who was one of his first computers, and he keeps harassing us.
He sends us an email every December that says, where's my 1108?
Right. Yeah.
It's right. The UNIVAC computer.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think hopefully we'll get him up for a lot of money if we ever find one. So out there to look for it. But I think in a funny way, strangely enough, I'd like to have the first Unix. We didn't have that. It's grown. We can't find that first code that ran on the PDP-7. And I think it's a shame to not be able to run that first program there. I mean, if you go to Manchester, they can run the first program on their machine. At SAC, I think, probably can run their first programs. It would be lovely to have the first Unix that ran there and sort of then be able to trace how that how that grew and, you know, what's happened, morphed around and in various ways. So maybe that might be it.
I think one of the changes we're making here is an emphasis on software, which I think did not exist in the Boston days. And if there was, if there's any single kind of philosophical defect in the plan that was otherwise perfect that you set out in Boston, was that you weren't from an early day collecting and studying software. And we're trying to fix that and collect as much software as possible. It's surprisingly hard. You know, you'd think that it's just bits or listings. It would be easy to find and discover, but it's not. And even the hardware is hard. Look, IBM made 15,000 1401s, and there are probably less than a dozen that exist now. Mm. So even though the history of the field doesn't go back very far, you wind up having to do archaeology on things that are only 20, 30, or 40 years old, and software is among that.
Yeah, let me, in terms of the some of the ways that collecting were done, probably the most successful collecting campaign we ever had was the contest to collect the first PC. Mm. And that brought basically 500 computers out of the woodwork of various forms. And that was, and Pat McGovern of IDG, I think, funded that, and we had, the exhibit was just a massive pile of computers, which was on down in the, which you saw, and probably the best exhibit of those was in the visible storage two, where they were all
on a rack. On one of the first things you saw.
On a rack, you could see racks and racks of these early machines.
It's a perfect example of how hard history is.
Yeah.
The fact that you asked for the first PC and you got 500 contributions, each of which thought they were the first PC.
Yeah.
Well, one of the things I've come to learn and love about engineers is that they're such pack rats. They save everything. And our, especially our trail of software has been made a lot warmer because almost every great engineer has saved every piece of code he or she's ever written.
That's right.
Yeah. There's an interesting question. This is the last one I'll take from the audience, which is, does the binary code on the logo stand for anything? So that logo was designed by the firm run by one of our wonderful trustees, Peggy Burke, 1185 Design. And it's endured. It was on the original beta building design that you showed. So it goes way back. Do you know the story about that?
No, it was Peggy Burke's design or her firm's design. I don't know whether that's a code of something or not. I think people are drawing the analogy to the punched card code, which is in the lobby, which in fact does have a secret message in it.
Yes, it does.
I suspect this represents too few bits to have much of a message.
Well, and we've recently just modified it.
Highly
because
compressed.
In a mobile world, your logo has to change to be more legible on the small screen. So there used to be four what we call lollipops on the logo, and those were intended to be a bit of a visual pun for a family of four coming to the museum. So we now joke that the oldest daughter grew up and went to college.
I didn't.
And now it's a family of three. Okay, so one final question, which is to both of you. Did you ever dream when you were first starting out doing this that this would be what we would be in 2014? You first, Gordon.
I thought it might be a little bit earlier. I'm generally wrong in terms of how long it takes to takes things far longer to do stuff.
You're the impatient optimist.
Yeah, I'd say at one point I thought of the model of it's got to be a distributed museum because of the way it's done, and that's why we had. At one point, the chairman of NEC, we had people from Fujitsu, we had ICL, chairman of ICL and places like that to get this, something that would be more of a distributed museum. But in its current form, it was, I thought that, I don't remember when it was like our first stuff of it's got to be, we've got to move to where the action is. We felt very strongly that, particularly I did after I abandoned the East Coast in 86 or so. That was
the West was where it was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's where it's happening.
Lynn, how about you?
Well, I share Gordon's surprise with how long it takes. I never would have predicted I'd still be doing this 18 years later. And I didn't know if we were the ones that would become an important international institution, but I knew somebody had to do it. You know, computers are a big deal, and it's not just for Silicon Valley and those of us in the industry. It's for the world. We are changing civilization, and we are a privileged generation because we're living through the step function where that is changing everyone's life. And we have the opportunity to record how that happened for people 500 or 1,000 years from now. So someone ought to be doing it, and I'm very pleased that we're the ones who are doing it.
Thanks. Well, it merits echoing what Lynn and Gordon have said, and it's on the slide up there. Thank you to all of you, because you represent the core of what is great and what helps us grow as an institution with your support and your commitment to the museum in every way. So thank you very much. I hope you've enjoyed this today, and please stay and enjoy the museum for the rest of the afternoon. Thank you.